Good morning, everyone. So a simple disclaimer here. I'm bad at designing presentations, so there will be lots of text. Be aware of it, there will be text. Okay, so the title that I chose was When the Internet Bleeded, because bleeding was the word which was used to explain a bug which was recently found, which is Heartbleed. And like we had a show of hands, everyone knows about Heartbleed. Okay, now, besides OpenSSL, is there any other software which is vulnerable to Heartbleed? Anyone has an idea about it? Or is it just the OpenSSL which is vulnerable? 1F, exactly. Now, that is where the internet word is not sufficient. It's not the entire internet. We always keep bashing about some competitors or some proprietary softwares, but in this case, it was only the open source OpenSSL package which was vulnerable, neither the GNU TLS nor any other package at all. So besides Heartbleed, what I basically wanted to cover up here was a brief understanding, a brief overview of the various bugs which were shown recently. These bugs, these six bugs, have popped in recently in various SSL stacks, various SSL cipher suites, or in various SSL versions. Now, those bugs, what it means for a developer, what it means for an administrator, that's what I wanted to convey out. So we'll start with basic idea about what these bugs are. We'll cover Heartbleed in detail, because that's the recent one. We'll cover up some demos, and there's a hands-on, so if someone has laptop available with Python installed, because that's the only requirement, you can actually try it out live. We have a server set up where you can actually see Heartbleed in action. Now, this is a bold statement, but is kind of a truth at this era where we have seen lots of disclosures from a lot of outside world countries claiming that they have capabilities to snoop on traffic. We have seen disclosures where companies are shown to have received money to weaken their algorithms. And the six bugs that I'm going to discuss about. All this means that the security protocols which are there, we can assume that most of them are broken. Either someone has found a flaw, or someone has bribed to get a flaw. So SSL has, in terms, now turned into insecure socket layer. So I'll just give you a 1,000-feet view. This is not the technical view. This is the high-level overview of the six bugs. So Heartbleed. This picture is courtesy XKCD. How many of you know XKCD? Okay, those who don't know about it, I would suggest visit that site. It's an awesome site, especially for someone who is in IT industry. So this basically summarizes Heartbleed in a very quick glimpse. So OpenSSL, around 2011, close to the New Year time, introduced a feature which was known as Heartbeat. Basically, a request would be sent from client to server, or from one end to the other end, requesting, if you are alive, send me a response back. So just like in this case, server, are you still there? Reply me with potato. And he mentioned it's a six-letter word. So server saw it, server saw the request, responded back with six letters, which is potato. Now, he again sent a request. Reply, bird, four-letter word. Server sees it, responds back, bird, four-letter word. Now, this is where, in security domain, what we generally tell everyone is, never trust user input. And this is what was the flaw. See the next request. Server, are you still there? If yes, reply with hat. It's a three-letter word. But he gave an input, 500 letters. And the response came back with not just hat, but the next consecutive memory segments up to 500 characters. all of that came back. Now this looks like, okay, yes, it's a buffer overflow, a normal, simple flaw. What can happen? So when we deep dive into it, I'll talk about what exactly our people are able to extract, including your server private key. The SSL private key is also exploitable here. The other two bugs, I hope these two diagrams are clear. No? Okay. Looks better? Okay, so this particular screenshot is actually the GNU TLS patch log. They recently patched a particular flaw wherein they were actually using a go to function to go to cleanup. Instead, now they are shifting to go to fail. This particular patch was in response to another flaw which was discovered in Apple. Now, how many of you are developer here? Okay, everyone understands how a if condition works in C. Okay, can anyone spot a flaw? There's already a comment which says, what is the flaw? So there are a large number of if conditions. That's what you can see. Now, the funny thing that you'll realize is the if condition, the statements after if conditions are not enclosed within brackets. So the, yes, exactly. So the general assumption that C language makes is if there's no bracket, the next preceding statement is within if condition, not the statement after that. And this is where this kind of mistake would have happened with a lot of people. While typing some word, you pressed a random keystroke and a line get copied just below it. Similarly, there's a go to fail two times. Exactly at this place. Now what happens is, this condition is checked. If this condition is true, go to fail. If this condition is not true, then go to fail. Otherwise, go to fail. So the last condition is not checked at all. And the certificates, even if they were not valid, even if they were not working properly, they were accepted as valid certificates. So this was an Apple bug, a proprietary source code. Someone found a flaw in this. Then GNU TLS looked at its own code and they corrected their own code also. Innocent mistakes, which go-to statement to use. Now let's not get into a debate that if by using Python, this would not have occurred, or any other language. We have to stick to C because of n number of reasons. One of them primarily being the large number of code base that we have right now. So, if someone wants to know the deep dive technical details, they can just use these URLs. These are for the specific bugs. GNU TLS is extensively covered in this extensial.com blog, and Apple bug at Impervia Violet. And gotofail.com is a site where you can check your Apple products. Okay, another question that came in mind. How many of you have Apple devices? Out of those, how many have jailbroken devices? Okay, and that jailbroken device, have you updated it or not because of losing jailbreak? Not updated. So a jailbroken device, you will not update because a jailbreak will not work with the latest version. Now by that, you actually get some facilities, but you're losing on fixes like these, which is kind of crucial at this point. Okay, now this is, I've just combined 3-4 bugs here. The first one, Beast. In SSL 3.0 and onwards, we have been using cipher suites. One of the commonly used cipher suites was CBC ciphers. Now, CBC cipher works on chain. Now, those chain had predictability. That's what Beast tried to exploit. If you're using CBC ciphers, you may be vulnerable to beast because the total encrypted package could be enumerated out and identified what is the actual encryption key, and the whole data could be decrypted using this particular bug. Now, all these four, why I've combined all these four at this place? Because although they are proven, there are white papers, there are academic researchers around it which says that this is possible. Supercomputers can do it. A normal person or a normal adversary might not be able to do it very quickly. But these are still relevant attacks which do happen. Now, the same person, the same group which found Beast, the next year they found Crime. Crime was associated with compression. So, Google was banking a lot on SPDY. SPDY protocol by default works on compression mode. Now that, as well as if you're using HTTPS compression, this was again vulnerable to enumeration and identification because of the compression algorithms that were used. Lucky 13, another timing attack. So these three, four attacks are largely in the academia, not actually exploited too much, but they're still there. RC4, how many of you know about RC4? Okay, and so there are a lot less people. So RC4 is another cipher suite which is used in SSL communication, known to be vulnerable for a large timeline, but when Beast came up, that was a point when version 3.0 of SSL or TLS 1.0 had two main cipher suites, RC4, CBC. Now CBC is vulnerable. Most of the pen testing organizations or the security companies reverted to recommending that turn off CBC and switch to RC4. And that was the recommendation that went in. A lot of people do implemented it out. But the problem is RC4 in itself is not a secure protocol. So this particular link basically talks about three, four different attacks on RC4. So this particular thing you can look at. Now, my primary focus is on Heartbleed. So if the time permits, we'll look into these. But otherwise, the primary focus will be on Heartbleed. So the current state, TLS 1.0 or SSL 3.0, all cipher suites, everything on SSL 3.0 is broken. Either an exploit is available or it is possible conceptually. Now, just like I said, if you protect against Beast, you are vulnerable to Lucky 13 or RC4 related attacks. So it's a catch-22 situation right now. And the funny part about it is, TLS 1.1, TLS 1.2 have been in system, I think, for a large number of years. People are working on RFC for 1.3. However, we still do not have 1.1 and 1.2 enabled on HTTPS servers. How many of you were still using Windows XP till it went end of life? Anyone? Okay. That had its own set of IE-related applications which were installed in it, IE6, IE7. Now, these older versions of browsers, they do not support TLS 1.1, 1.2. That have been the primary reason why websites were not kind of willing enough to enable 1.1 and 1.2. But now, this basically, the current range of attacks which are there, this has basically shown that, okay, now is the time. You have to move ahead. You have to make sure that you have better algorithms, better encryption standards available, and use them proactively. So, getting back to Heartbleed. So, the Heartbleed, the interesting part about Heartbleed was not that much into the technical part, but more of into the marketing section. This was the first bug in past 5 to 8 years, I would say, which was marketed very well. Before public disclosure, before anyone got a whiff of it, the company, the one of the company which found it, had a domain registered for it. So heartbeat.com was registered first, and then parties were informed that, okay, such kind of a flaw exists, and then people started patching things. So there was a very effective marketing which basically helped in one way. Most of the attacks that happen, they are generally limited to security industry. Even developers and admins get that only via there is a patch available which fixes some security issues related to CVE XXX YYY. And an admin or a developer will see, okay, some security fix has happened, I'll just update it and I'm done with it. But this bug was marketed properly, so everyone keeps talking about it. That's why we have so many hands saying, yes, we know about Heartbleed. The simplest definition or a simplest abstract of this is, it's a lucky draw. You ask for some data, you may get any kind of a data, and data is not equal to information. You may get valuable information, you may not get valuable information. Now, this actually invoked a lot of Twitter reactions. So I am an avid follower on Twitter, so I just cataloged some reactions which were there. The first reaction, very accurate, very true, but still disheartening. It's a memory disclosure bug. People were cribbing about it, but it's not the end of the world. It's an open source code. Anyone can look at it. Anyone can try and find more such flaws. The last year has shown you're safe as long as you don't use SSL, Apple devices, GNU TLS, NIST standards, emails, or cell phones. That basically covers up everyone, one or the other thing. Then someone came up with a T-Shark-based query which can actually detect if Heartbleed is happening, if someone is trying to query Heartbleed on your server. Now this guy, Troy Hunt, had a very interesting thought about it. The trick is not about patching servers. The trick is about identifying where else OpenSSL 1.0.1 till 1.0.1f is used. And we'll see where else it is used. Another similar reaction. Let's patch things. What about your routers, switches? How many of you have networking components on your network and probably end-of-life products or your support has expired? Anyone here? Because I've seen cases where the support has expired because of one or the other policy reason, and now they're hang up with not having an update. So your VPNs, gateways, WAFs, ESX servers, n number of other devices, they all rely on OpenSSL. Freely available code, anyone can copy it, anyone can use it. So everyone is using it. Start SSL. How many of you know about Start SSL? I think Hasgeek also uses Start SSL. Yeah, so Start SSL provides you a free certificate for first year. Now, in this particular scenario, Heartbleed, since there was a potential chance that the private key might be disclosed, it was suggested that you revoke your certificate and create a new certificate with new passwords, new keys. The certification revocation from Start SSL was costing something, around $24. Then the last one. Microsoft OCSP takes 24 hours to mark a certificate as revoked. OCSP is a method by which you can basically identify if the certificate is revoked or not. And browsers basically query it and see, okay, yes, this certificate is revoked. And if it is revoked, it shows an error. Now that takes 24 hours. So even if you have done all the work on your end, your certificate is still valid for 24 hours. Okay, now this is what I have actually configured right now. There's a live server at heartbleed.anandshree.info. It's an Amazon hosted image. So the demo, I'll try to see if I can show you the video demo. If that does not work, we'll try to do it live. And those who have the laptops with them, they can basically use these two scripts. Test.txt is a shell script, and hbtest.txt is a Python file. Like I said, I'm a lazy presenter. I'm also a lazy coder. So this hbtest.txt is not my original creation. It was a publicly available source code. I just took it, modified it a bit to make it look a bit beautiful. And then the shell script basically runs this Python file 9,000 times to just make sure you get as much data as possible. Now on this server, I've configured two login pages, login_post.html, login.html, which is basically login pages. Underscore post obviously goes via post, and .html is the normal login where you have a GET request. I know the login pages would look like ridiculously stupid because there's no PHP language or no server-side language here. It's just two HTML pages sending post request or GET request to each other. But we'll see. Okay, so I hope this works. Okay, this looks like ridiculously stupid right now because I've inverted colors, because I had an assumption that black background with white text looks absolutely brilliant on presentations, but it proved wrong, so we'll just see. So this is one particular page which I've configured, login_post.html. I've obviously not configured the actual certificate, it's a self-signed certificate. Now this is, I know for the people in back, it's three white blobs, but I'll just try to explain what exactly it is with the help of a little zoom. Okay, so this is one screen which is basically capturing the access log on the server, the actual server where hard bleed is possible. Now you can see, I've done a tail minus f, and you can see two GET requests, login_post.html and favicon.io. And the host name is hardbleed.anandshree.info. Now the other one, this is another server which is available online, which I'm using to attack. Now, the machine which I have here is the client trying to access the server, and this client bleed.anandshree.info is the attacker. It is trying to get the username and password used here. And this is just a simple watch over grep just to see if I've got the username or not. So if you proceed forward, like I said about that shell script, test.txt on hardbleed.anandshree.info, this is nothing but a wrapper over the actual Python file running it 9,000 times. Now, I agree we can do that inside Python. I was short of time on that and skill set too. So I went with a shell script. So I'm starting the shell script on this window, which basically will be running the Python file continuously for 9,000 times and extracting the output from server. Now, if you look closely in this, trying 48 attempt, connecting, sending client hello, client request sent, a connection established, hard bleed request sent. Now received hard bleed response. And you can see some garbage text here. Now what I've done is, you basically are receiving 64 KB of data, but I've extracted out only the ASCII character set out of it. So it's just the ASCII output that is there. So this guy is basically trying to extract whatever it can from the server. At that same point, I went back to the login page. And I've tried a username password, username being rootconf2014 and a password. We'll just see what exactly is the password. Once you submit this request, it's a post request, you get a message, some request response submitted, and you can see here, there's a post request received by the server. Now the logs will not have a value, username, password, because it's a post request. Supposedly, this should only be visible between the client and the server. No one else should have this value. No one else should be able to extract this value. Now, since it's a lucky draw, I'm just spending some time trying to see if some other password, just submit one or two more requests. So this was rootconf rocks. And by the time the second request went in, if you look closely here, is this text visible? Username rootconf2014, password root_conf_2014. Post data over HTTPS, supposedly only visible between client and server. A third server or a third box is able to extract this data. That's the minimal impact of Heartbleed, extraction of sensitive information from the server memory, which is related to session. So just like you have this username password combinations, you'll have keys, you'll have API keys, you will have cookies, any DAM data that is traveling between server and client and is available in the memory, adjacent memory to Heartbleed request, you'll be able to extract that out. All right, so now this was all talk. So how much time is over yet? It's already done. Okay, so all right, I've exceeded the time limit. Any questions from anyone? Or if there's no question, I'll just like to show one more demo, which is like 5 minutes max, which is related to client attack. Okay. Just a sec. Looks ugly. Okay, so in this, the two screens, one is actually showing you an Android emulator, where the Android version is 4.1.1, which is again a vulnerable version using this OpenSSL. The other window is from the other server, which is ClientBleed server. And I'll just show how you can actually extract data from a client memory. So I've made some search queries here. Rootconf related entries came up. I've opened one or two websites here. HasGeek I've opened. I've opened Rootconf again. So now these all requests which I'm making are over HTTPS because we are targeting HTTPS memory here. Rootconf opens another HTTPS based site. I can try login. Now, Does anyone remembers what was the first site that opened? Google.com. And Android browsers have a notorious habit. Whenever you open Google.com, they first try to log you in using the credential, whatever is available on the device. So just keep that in mind when we look at the output. Now I've tried 2-3 combination of usernames and passwords. For one, it said username is not correct. For the other, it said incorrect password, which in itself is a different class of issues. Yeah, I know. Yes. So now I'm trying to access this clientbleed.anandshree.info, which will be running a exploiting server. Now what this means is, now on this box, I have this pacemaker software. I'll give you the URL. This pacemaker software, this pacemaker Python script is actually a server-side exploitation. So this will exploit a client. When you run this, you go back to your client, you refresh the page. Now you see here, this bucket load of data that is coming in. And anyone can see at the bottom, the second last line? Google account, test login and pass equals to password. This was the username password which was there in the device for my Google account. Plus, you can see the server certificates for RootConf and HasGeek, whatever sites we opened up, the server certificate information, the public component, as well as other information is visible plainly in the server. So whatever data was there with the client, be it for that particular site or be it for any site at all, that can again be extracted out. So that's another component where people have not given a lot of thought. Okay, how many of you own a website here? Have your own website? And to have more usability, you have some kind of a place where you can input a URL and the content of the URL will be fetched. Like an image can be used via a URL as your profile picture. Kind of facility that generally sites have. Now, if that URL is kind of this kind of a server URL, and the internal component which is actually fetching the URL is vulnerable, you will bleed out the memory from that particular server. So those are some of the potential impacts. Now, we can start the questions if anyone has. And this is the pacemaker Python file. You can download it from GitHub.
Hey Anand, so just want to confirm. So what you got is not the server's private certificate, but the public certificate from the client.
From the client. So public certificate is one part. Like you saw, the Google account login is what we got. So anything that is there in the client memory, I can extract that out.
Okay, but you need to basically be able to talk to the client, which means the client should have an IP that you can access.
No. Client is sending a request.
Right, but how do you get anything out of the client's memory?
So
you're essentially making a Heartbleed request to the client.
So the Heartbleed is two-way. It's not one-way.
So the server can get this out of the client.
Yes.
But in this case, I'm curious about how you do this, make this work for a third party. Can you, for instance, listen on the network, find all clients that are currently on the LAN and go get information out of them for what they're doing?
No. The client first has to make a request.
Okay.
The client has to establish a connection.
So this is essentially a way for a server to go break into all the clients connecting to it.
Yes. Or let's say you have a web page which has an image tag with an SRC pointing to an attacking server. So automatically client will make a connection and you can then extract the information.
Okay.
So just like you basically exploit an XSS attack or a CSRF attack. Any other questions? Now, since I'm, just like I said to this guy earlier, I tend to just go in the flow and miss out the timelines. So I missed out the timeline. This is what I wanted to discuss more. But since the time is out, so any other question that is there? 3 more minutes? Okay. So now the basic question that was there in everyone's mind, what is there for an administrator? What is there for a developer? In short words, for administrator, you have to make sure your patches are up to date. You're monitoring properly. And in olden days, it was like, okay, there's large chunk of log files. I cannot monitor all the logs with big data in place, with massive computation power that is there. You can do a lot of correlation, coreference. Just do that. Build a system where you do correlation. You try to find out anomalies, like a person logging in from India, and within 5 minutes of that person logging in from India, he's logging in from US. Although concurrent logins might be disabled, should be disabled, they are not disabled in most of the sites, and that might actually trigger a warning for you that, okay, that there is concurrent logins happening. You might want to look at it. Now, for the developers, how many of you distribute packaged softwares where you have all the dependencies packaged into the same executable? All right. I think largely there'll be web developers. Okay. How many of you use jQuery? Self-hosted version. Okay. And do you religiously update that? Do you know that with jQuery, there are a large number of CVEs available with vulnerabilities, including DOM accesses and a lot of other issues? So similar to this particular thing, where you are using a self-hosted jQuery, a JavaScript library, if you are distributing packaged dependencies like OpenSSL, you have to make sure you update that also. Because there are 75 Cisco devices, not the number of devices, but the type of devices which are vulnerable. And they have to update because they had a packaged dependency and that dependency is vulnerable. Yesterday or today early morning, CA has said that there are a large number of CA products which are vulnerable. And they are releasing advisories around it. Now, the technical solution is to enable TLS 1.1, 1.2, enable perfect forward secrecy, revoke SSL certificate. Obviously, there is a cost involved. Make sure you're not using any of the existing secrets, neither the password nor the key. You're secure till no one finds another flaw. Policy-based solutions. Like, there was a question at the start. How many of you actually changed your passwords? So that's the second point. Forced password reset. Don't ask them to change the password. Lock all the accounts, ask them to have a new password and then log in. Fail hard, fail early. If you see some discrepancy in the network, some problem, react. React immediately. Inform them. If you see it's a login related stuff, block login request for some time. Monitor it and then continue. The other part is API keys. We have those beautiful REST APIs where you have GET requests with the API keys in them. That or the POST request with those API keys, those are all vulnerable with this particular thing. So overall, I think leaving aside nothing in this, everything is vulnerable via one or the other attack. Windows XP, out of support. Sun workstations, out of support. Media PC, depending on Windows or Linux, whatever it is. Laptop, again, depending on OS. Wireless transport, ATM router, modem, switches. Those devices, depending on what are the dependencies that they have included. Sun SolarWinds, again, support. Cell phones, PDAs, depending on what kind of new OS you're using, Android, iOS, Firefox OS, whatever that is. So the entire landscape, if you look at, everything is vulnerable. So a caution has to be taken from everyone. The understanding has to be there that, yes, this problem is there, and the solution is not easy. It is not just a technical solution that you upgrade everything and you're done. You buy a new product and you're done. There's also some policy that you have to follow. There is also some approach that you have to follow. A large number of companies are profiting via open source softwares, but they're not contributing back. I think on this, Red Hat actually does a lot of good work. They contribute back. But there are very less organizations which are doing that. And that is one of the core reasons of such kind of flaws going unnoticed, even though the source code is publicly available. So that's kind of the end of my boring, long presentation. If anyone has any question, if they are still not sleeping.
I think it's definitely a wonderful talk. I'm sure our heart is bleeding now, right? Any interesting one last question? We are so tempted to, you know, the time is up, but we still wanted to see such an interesting talk. You know, there is one interesting question from the audience. The heart is really bleeding, huh?
Everyone's bored.
So there is one here.
I'm a basic operations person, so yeah. I'm having a very dumb question here. What happens to layers where the application server is talking to a database system where it's an encrypted password, but we had to update across the fleet. Yes. But I try to understand what happens to that database layer with something like this. Because okay, it's just an app connecting JDBC connectivity, passwords, yes, we encrypt, all of that's fine, but why?
Okay, now on that, you remember I gave you an example where a person can actually give you a URL and your application is basically trying to fetch some content from it. Now, those kind of requests, now with database and app server connectivity, I am actually short of examples right now. But in general, even if it's an internal network device, you have a front load balancer which is terminating SSL point and you may have whatever kind of connections inside. The termination point is the external attack point, where someone can directly talk to the server and extract data. The other way of extracting data would be forcing your server to make a connection to someone, either as a client or as a server. Mm-hmm. So if your server is making external connections, you still have a point of vulnerability there, okay, just like the client piece which I showed. Right. So that's...
Makes sense. Thank you.
Thanks, Anand. Wonderful talk.
Yep.
Round of applause, guys.
Thanks a lot.